Let me try to introduce briefly today's speaker. It is a pleasure to welcome Professor Slava Mukanov of the Ludwig Maximilian University in Munich. Professor Mukanov is a major figure in cosmology, a field to which he gave seminal contributions, some of which you will hear about in this colloquium. If one could summarize in one word or so, he predicted that a short period of accelerated expansion, usually termed inflation, that, as we have reasons to believe, accompanied the early stages of our universe, would leave a definite imprint on the cosmic microwave background. The Planck satellite mission did the rest, showing that this imprint is really there. I would add, for the benefit of mathematicians, that this discovery is also a peculiar application of Bessel functions in a different context. People may be familiar with the fact that Bessel functions, or Hankel functions in detail, oscillate at one end and they go and exhibit a power-like behavior at the other one. Well, this power-like behavior is what signals the classicalization of quantum fluctuations. That is what he will tell us about. Professor Mukanov also wrote some books, including a major text in cosmology. And while reading it, one sees very clearly that he has not only a deep knowledge of cosmology, but a wide and profound knowledge that touches all major aspects of theoretical physics, from particle physics to quantum field theory to gravity proper. Professor Mukanov has received an impressive number of awards, which include the Oscar Klein Medal, the Planck Medal, the Amaldi Medal of SIGGRAPH, the Gruber Prize in Cosmology, and the Pascal Chair in France. Thank you very much.
Okay, today's talk will be rather general, and I will tell you, okay, the things just about cosmology, what happened, because there during last 25 years, because if we go before 90s, cosmology was like field of theology. As some priest said, it was natural philosophy. But since 1990, it converted to the natural science thanks to brilliant experiment, okay, about which I will be speaking, made on sky, for instance, for measuring this kind of fine structure picture of the universe when it was much younger than today. Today it's about 13 billion years, but people were able to get direct photograph of the universe when it was just 300,000 years old, and they identify on these photographs the embryons from which galaxies originated. And the most amazing thing that actually these properties of these embryons happened to come in the full agreement with the theory. Theoretical prediction. Okay, let me start with some blah, blah, blah. Okay, going back to the history, because you understand that people always were interested in cosmology. And for instance, when Weinberg was writing his book, First 3 Minutes, and by the way, actually, the only reason perhaps for writing this book was impressive calculation of nucleosynthesis in the earlier universe. He wrote in his book something what I, honestly speaking, didn't expect from Weinberg, but he wrote that the efforts to understand the universe is one of the very few things that lifts human life a little bit above the level of farce. It sounds great, and after that, let me go directly to the conclusions of my talk. I will make them twice, once at the end and once at the beginning for those people who will not stay to the end, you see? And now I make this conclusion in pictures, okay? So you have see here not Hollywood, but real photographs. One is the photograph of the hydrogen atom. obtained with the help of this electronic microscope in the ground state, and it refers to the scales 10⁻¹ centimeter, and the other is direct picture of the early universe, how it looked like when it was just 300,000 years old. And it refers to the scale 10⁻²⁸ centimeters, or 13 billion light years, okay? And you could ask what these pictures have to do with each other. And I can tell you that behind of both these pictures is the same formula, which is called Heisenberg uncertainty relation, which in principle is in the foundation of the whole quantum theory. And this uncertainty relation tells us that there cannot be the state of absolute rest in the nature. There is always some kind of minimal level of Parkinson, which every body of us has, you see? So now, let me go a little bit to the blah, 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 blah talk, because you understand that, of course, when I ask you question, who were the first people about whom we know for sure who were thinking about universe, and everybody will answer immediately. They were ancient Greeks, yeah? And the guy who was the first to introduce so-called multiverse, who you think was it, was Democritus, of course, who also introduced atoms, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But it's all at the level of blah, 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 of course. At level of blah, blah, blah is not a real science. And even ancient Greek, blah, 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 was not taken as a real science, as you see from this quote of La Fontaine. Yeah, he is a French, but because I don't speak French, it's not so nice, but translation, that our fellow citizens, they said, had lost his mind. Reading has ruined Democritus. If he knew less, he would have more sympathy from us. There are more worlds, he claims, in number infinite, and each of them may have in it another Democritus. How does it sound? Like New York Times or recent Scientific American, yeah? But, okay, since Democritus, we made no progress in this direction, but people now are not as reasonable as ancient Greeks, therefore, some people are discussing this crap, which I want to avoid all together, right, in my talk. Instead of that, I will speak in a different thing, but for this different thing, actually, let me tell you some story from Kabbalah. I got this story from François Engler, who wanted to use it with a different purpose, but this is real story, I will give reference, okay? At a certain point, God, who was alone, was bored to be alone. And because he was bored, he decided to create something like universe. But then God got immediately in trouble because God was everywhere and there was no place to create universe somewhere. Because God is smart, he found solution. He shrinked himself to the point and produced in the remaining space universe, expanded and found himself in extremely boring universe because nothing was happening there. It was absolutely symmetric, but of course Kabbalah doesn't specify it was Minkowski space, de Sitter or anti-de Sitter, but we know today that there were these three options. Then God think a little bit, okay, shrink himself again to the point. But before, okay, shrinking to the point, he distributed in this universe a little bit garbage. And then when he expanded, he found himself in a nice universe which was evolving. Because, and then today what we did actually, we identified the nature of this garbage, namely it happens that this garbage were quantum fluctuations. And this idea is expressed in Kabbalah, as I promised I give you reference, okay? In a nice way, only by their breaking could the divine configuration be perfected. So I will speak today about this garbage, or about this broken symmetry of the perfect universe, and how can we check that the universe really started with some kind of slightly broken phase. Now, as everybody knows, perhaps that there are stars. You can see them just on the sky. These stars are coming in the clusters. You see on these photographs, you could see these stars very clearly. And these clusters form what so people call galaxies, yeah? All of, you know, in average, these galaxies contain about 100 billion stars. It's very easy to memorize. You just think how much money all these kind of advanced Russian, new Russian have stolen, yeah? In average. So also there is some variation, of course. So, but people for very long time have seen some kind of nebulae on the photographs and they could not identify what are these nebulae. They didn't know about their origin. You see, for instance, in Messier catalog, I think in 19th century, yeah? There was about 134 of these nebulas, half of which happened to be galaxies also. But before 1920, and before 1920, nobody could prove that these nebula, some of them could be separate galaxies or clusters of the stars outside of our galaxies. And for the first time, using this Mount Wilson telescope built in 1920s, next to Los Angeles, Hubble was able to identify particular stars in the Andromeda and assuming that he knows absolute luminosity of this star, he calculated what should be different distance to this Andromeda, and for the first time, he proved that Andromeda is outside of our Milky Way and is more or less the same galaxy as our galaxy. Of course, today, with the development of the telescope, we know how many different galaxies we have within observable part of the whole universe, and not be surprised, it's again 100 billion galaxies. So total mass of the universe is about 10 in power 55 gram, you see? And moreover, when Hubble was making observations, he discovered that if you will take some galaxies which are not far away from us, that the spectra of the line elements in these galaxies are a little bit redshifted. And he interpreted this redshift as a Doppler shift, okay, which you know quite well. Hubble listened galaxy instead of train, but you understand that actually listening, this guy, you know, it gets away from you or comes to you. Okay, the same thing happened to be with galaxies, and then what Hubble discovered, he found that the galaxy, which are at large enough distances away from us, are escaping from us with the speed proportional to the distance to these galaxies. And for instance, nearby galaxies are separated from us by the distance which light typically travels several million years. You see, but of course, the whole universe, light goes through the lifetime of the universe, which is 13 billion years. Now, of course, if I would show you the data, you would be just laughing also actually, but nevertheless, Hubble had the right intuition, and assuming that he knows luminosity of some galaxies, he defined what is called now Hubble constant, in spite of the fact that this coefficient, this is speed with which galaxy is escaping, this is distance to the galaxy, and this coefficient of proportionality is called Hubble constant, although, of course, it's function of time, but today, on the times of the order of 10 billion years, it changes typically on the years of billion years. Therefore, for us, it's constant. If you will forget about gravity, divide distance by the speed, then this quantity is measurable, then you will get that 13.7 billion years ago, now today it's known with high accuracy, all galaxies were together, and all galaxies were occupying, which we see today, the space which was smaller than 1 cubic centimeter. Although, okay, it's hard to imagine, nevertheless, it contradicts to nothing. Therefore, immediately after this discovery, people realized that our universe started with some kind of big bang explosion with big velocities, and gravity was slowing down this expansion because gravity is attractive force, as people were thinking. And therefore, universe, people also realized, should have finite lifetime. So it was created at some moment of time. This was actually had in Soviet Union very unpleasant consequence because some guy, Zelmanov, who wrote the first part of his paper about this expanding universe which had the beginning, 1937, okay? He published the first part on his paper on cosmology, but second part was blocked until 1953. And he was able to publish second part of the paper only after 5th of March, 1953, when fortunately for Russia, or better to say for Soviet Union, some guy passed away. As you know, for some kind of strange reason, Soviet philosophers were not with the idea that universe exists just finite time. Perhaps they were not sure that 13 billion years is enough to build communism. I do not know what was the reason for them, you see. But nevertheless, this idea, of course, was taken seriously or semi-seriously for a very long time by very serious scientists, including those who made nuclear bombs, you see, in the United States, in Russia, because the first papers on cosmology were written by these people, serious papers, who were trying to explain the origin of helium in our universe. Because if you will look, for instance, intensity of the spectral lines from all these faraway galaxies, you can immediately, or very easily, with this spectroscopy, determine the matter composition of our universe. And then you will find that in our universe, okay, 75% of all matter, baryonic matter, is just normal hydrogen. 25% is helium-4. You could ask where is the rest in really trace amount, about which perhaps we could forget concerning its contribution to the total mass. This thing was known for a very long time, and in fact, you understand that people were trying to understand how to produce all this helium. Okay, because if you know the age of the universe, like 10 billion years, you know how much energy is released when you use two protons and two neutrons in the star to form helium-4. It's 28 MeV, yeah? You could calculate, in this case, the luminosity of the sky if all helium-4 was produced in the stars. And the number which you would get in this case would be 100 times more than we see on the sky. Therefore, you understand that, okay, this helium-4 cannot be produced in the stars, but where can you produce it? In fact, Gamow long ago suggested that perhaps all this H-bomb which you need to produce helium-4, you exploded when the universe was very young, just 3 minutes after birth. And then temperature at this time was so huge that nobody noticed even, okay, all these explosions. After that, universe cooled down, and there is no problem in this case with explanation of helium-4. And this idea was put forward in 1949. Of course, without real calculations, by Gamow, Hermann, Alper, and also Turkevich and Fermi, which, by the way, didn't publish paper on this topic because they used secret data from Los Alamos. They were working on the hydrogen bomb there, or nuclear bomb. But there was immediate consequence of this assumption that in such a case, there should be some remnant, okay, of these times when this helium was formed. Namely, there should survive some primordial radiation. And universe should be hot today, what people call hot. But nobody has seen this radiation until 1965. These two people, using this huge antenna, have found that irrespectively in which direction on the sky this antenna is pointing, Milky Way, okay, or in the cleanest part of the sky, it always sees the same noise with the temperature about 3 degrees. So from the darkest part of the sky, there come photon with the temperature which is around 3 degrees. And then, okay, they will explain that perhaps they see precisely what should survive from the Big Bang, okay, from this time when the universe was extremely hot. But it was not yet the proof that it's really those radiation, but not radiation which was formed before. Because to prove that this is really primordial radiation, you needed to show that the spectra is a Planck spectra. You see, so intensity of radiation depending on the frequency should give you this kind of curve. The only points which they were able to measure with this antenna were these few points in so-called relay genes part of the spectra where the things are growing linearly. And to measure things here, okay, atmosphere was not allowing us to do this thing. People were using balloon. Even in 1987, they used rocket on the low orbit. It was so-called Nagoya-Berkeley experiment, but what they got? They got 1987, huge deviation here from the Planckian spectrum. If these people would be right, 1987 would mark the end of cosmology as a science, as you understand, because nothing would be left from it. Fortunately, it was found that what people in Nagoya-Berkeley experiment have seen, they have seen just instrumental noise. Therefore, everything was okay. Some of them got prizes, but okay, it doesn't matter that the experiment was distinguished, okay? So you can forget about it. Now, if you will take this idea about expanding hot universe in past seriously, what is happening? Why I call it hot? Okay, 3 degrees by no standard is hot, right? It's, I would say, rather cold. It's minus 270 degrees of Celsius. You see low temperature physics. But if you will take into account the fact that universe is expanding and R is the radius of the universe, what is happening with this photon during expansion? Clearly, its wavelength is growing proportional to the size of the universe. If the photon wave's length is growing, frequency is decreasing, it means that it becomes less intensive or with low temperature, right? Therefore, you can show that if you would take this radiation, would look how the temperature of this radiation would depend on the size of the universe, you would find that it drops down inversely proportional to the size of the universe. From here, it follows immediate consequence. And when universe was 1,000 times smaller than it's right now, and was only 300,000 years old, the temperature of this radiation, which we see today, and which is primordial radiation, was around 3,000 degrees. And 3,000 degrees is already quite hot, as you know. Here doesn't matter, it's Kelvin or Celsius. If you go even further in past, then the temperature will be even higher, as you understand. But why this moment is so important? Because 3,000 degrees for the temperature is enough to ionize all the neutral hydrogen which we have today in our universe and which constitutes the most of the baryonic matter. So after this moment, most of the hydrogen was neutral. Before this moment, all the hydrogen was ionized. And if hydrogen was ionized, there was a lot of electrons. And you understand that, okay, to move electrons is much easier than the hydrogen atom as a total. It means that electrons before this moment were making the universe completely non-transparent. But after this moment, after temperature dropped to 3,000 degrees, okay, when universe was 300,000 years old, okay, then during 90,000 years, universe was becoming more and more and more transparent. At some moment of time, most of the radiation completely decoupled from the matter and came to this gentleman without any further scattering, delivering to him direct photograph of the universe, how it looked like when it was just 300,000 years old. Therefore, okay, observing this radiation, we see how universe looked like when it was much younger. And what this gentleman, Penzias and Wilson, have seen for very long time, and a lot of other experiments who were trying to see how temperature is changing depending on the direction on the sky. They have seen the temperature in all directions is precisely the same. What does it mean that temperature in all directions is precisely the same? It means that conditions in the universe were, when it was 300,000 years old, in all the places from which light is coming, were indistinguishable. It means that, for instance, the amount of matter and the amount of radiation here was precisely the same as the amount of matter and the amount of radiation here. So we would see in this picture completely homogeneous and isotropic universe. You see, completely homogeneous. I cannot say about isotropic because isotropic means, okay, in all directions, but here isotropic, homogeneous, yeah, but I am observing just two-dimensional picture here, you see? Now, and then you could ask the following question. Look at it. Something is wrong with it because here, when in universe no nothing, okay, no structure, etc., and here we see even this gentleman. We see these galaxies. And the question is how all these galaxies were formed because there should be something from what they could be formed, because we know that kids are not coming from nowhere, yeah? So, and therefore, one could ask natural question, where are these missing embryons from which galaxies originated later? Because how could you understand the origination of this structure? If you would assume that there was a little bit matter here, more matter a little bit here, then you could use gravitational instability to understand how inhomogeneities are growing. You see, because gravitational instability, in other words, is the same as the principle rich gets even richer. You see, so it means that those places where you have more matter attract matter from nearby regions. These nearby regions become empty and you have galaxy. And in fact, you can start with small inhomogeneities. For instance, like in this movie, which is not real movie, it's Hollywood produced on computer. Yeah? And then you see how inhomogeneities are growing, but there should be seeds if you want to have this kind of growth. If universe would not be expanding, that this kind of growth can be exponential. But Lifshitz showed in 1946 that in expanded universe, these inhomogeneities cannot grow faster than For instance, the size, then the rate of the growth of the size of the universe. So, if today they are of the order of unity, then at the time when universe was 1,000 times smaller, they should be at least, okay, 10 minus 3, so 1,000 times smaller, because they are growing proportional to the size of the universe. But if there was inhomogeneity at the level of 10 minus 3, 10 minus 4, okay, the picture which I showed before cannot be right. You see, and the picture which you would expect to see is much more interesting, should be much more interesting with all these different colors which show you variation of the temperature from one place to the other by 1/100 of the percent. So 10 minus 3, 10 minus 4. You see, if you would have this variation of density at the level of 10 minus 3, 10 minus 4, then today you could get one as a result of amplification of these inhomogeneities. People were making a lot of efforts. In Russia, there was built even this 600 meters radio telescope Rattan, okay, because Zeldovich was pushing this experiment, okay, with the purpose to find this variation of the temperature of background radiation on the sky, but nobody could get anything. Okay, in the 80s, when I came in science, of course, you understand when you are young. As I said today, you don't care too much about experiment, you care more about your dissertation and what your boss will tell you, okay, and how happy he will be with it. Therefore, okay, I tried to please mostly Ginzburg and Zeldovich, but not experiment, and I needed also to write my PhD. Therefore, at a certain point, just to have subject for PhD, we started to think, let's imagine that the picture was like this one, but let's now do not care about this thing, and let's ask the other question. If picture was really like this one, how can we explain the origin of this kind of different colors on this picture or the features of embryons on this picture? And then, okay, we started this work together with Chibisev in 1980, and also, okay, a year later after that, but independently, similar paper was published by Hawking, where we use the ideas of quantum mechanics to explain the origin of this picture, which still was not existing at the time when we were explaining it, you see? And if the thing doesn't exist yet, at the time when you are explaining it, you can make even prediction, and you tell the guy, when you will find it, it should have these features. But of course, at this time, I didn't care. I cared, but I knew that it's impossible, you see. I saw that maybe people will require 1,000 years to make this experiment, you see, but life happened to go much quicker, okay, and what was impossible, it looked fun. Absolutely impossible in 1990 happened to be perfectly possible in 2013. So you see, things sometimes are happening surprisingly fast. So the idea was that the origin of all these spots should be taken from the moment 300,000 years and referred to the moment of time, like 10 minus 33 seconds. Okay, you can tell me what this kind of crap you are talking about. Nobody knows even what is particle physics above 100 TV, yeah? But 110 TV, yeah, 100 TV. But I can tell you gravity has remarkable protection against all particle physicists. Namely, gravity is causal thing. And you could produce something there using some kind of process, and gravity would not touch this thing, would not touch this embryo for 300,000 years because they were in the scales which are larger than the size of causally connected region. So imagine that you produce something, put in the refrigerator, when, okay, 300,000 years passed, you take it from refrigerator and the embryo start to develop just precisely at this moment of time when they come in causal contact with each other. And today we can see them. Okay, so what was the idea? Idea was a little bit crazy, of course, Winderheit, was to use quantum mechanics. Of course, you can say, how can you think about galaxies in huge scale and about quantum mechanics, which is relevant only in very small scale? But if universe is expanding, you should not forget that all universe, all the galaxies which we see today, in past sometime, were within 1 cubic centimeter. And the galactic scale were microscopical scale. And at this point, you have to apply quantum mechanics. Now, you know, what is the origin of this whole thing? You know that if electron is moving around nuclei, it should emit radiation, right? Because otherwise, iPhone would not work. On the other hand, if electron is moving, emitting radiation, it loses energy. And it should end up in the center of the nuclei. So, would be catastrophe, matter would be unstable. So how to make iPhone working and other life simultaneously? The answer to that is very simple, okay? It's possible to do using quantum mechanics, because according to quantum mechanics, when electron comes too close to the hydrogen atom, it starts to try to escape like crazy, because it has to satisfy Heisenberg uncertainty relation, according to which minimal uncertainty of momentum multiplied by minimal uncertainty of the position should exceed what people call Planck constant. And this kind of behavior stabilizes electron on so-called ground state, on the minimal possible orbit. You see, and of course, thanks to this quantum mechanics, we are able to have electromagnetic radiation and be alive. But thanks to the same uncertainty relation, we are able also to produce ourselves, because, okay, according to the uncertainty relation, there always exist unavoidable quantum fluctuations. It means that you cannot distribute matter arbitrarily, highly homogeneously, perfectly homogeneously, because to distribute matter perfectly homogeneously, you have to put all particles, okay, in fixed position and fix their velocities precisely. But because particles are doing like this one, they are always introduce the small variation in any homogeneous, unavoidable variation in any kind of maximally homogeneously possible state of the matter. And the question at this time was, is it possible to amplify this minimal quantum fluctuation to the amplitude when it will become possible to produce galaxy out of them? Also, you should understand that these kind of perturbations, okay, are very large, for instance, in the Planck scale, which are 10 minus 33 centimeter. But today, galactic scale, they are, would correspond to gravitational potential 10 minus 58, nothing, you see? But you have to get in galactic scale 10 minus 5. Therefore, question was, could you amplify these kind of fluctuations to the scales, in the right scales, to the right value by 50 orders of magnitude. And then what we showed, that if you will take normal universe, when you start with infinite velocities, and gravity just slows down your expansion, it's impossible. But on the other hand, actually, this kind of universe is like this bloody car. We just start. To decrease its speed, okay? When you see this car, the next question, but how this bloody car got this so high speed? And you know how it got, right? You got it like this. cosmological picture of the universe would not be to start with infinite velocity of unknown origin, but to assume that it's like car. You start with zero velocity, put, okay, your leg on the gas, it speeds up, then, okay, you put your leg on the brake, and then it speeds down. Very logical picture. But people were thinking about gravity like it's always like this one. But here you needed to find what kind of ingredient could be responsible for this speeding up of our universe. And today we know what is this. It's dark energy in our universe, which, by the way, was confirmed that it exists for sure. But today's dark energy, which we see, completely useless. But the idea would be just to take the similar component and put it in the past. Then you explain the origin of Big Bang, a lot of blah, blah, blah. But simultaneously on this stage, as we proved, that only on this stage you can amplify quantum fluctuations to the needed value in expanding universe. Today, people, okay, some people claim that they found the way how to amplify them in contracting universe to get the same result. But it's problem of these people. I do not want to speak about it. Let me concentrate on quantum fluctuations and on the consequences of amplification of quantum fluctuations. So if we make this kind of assumption, then we immediately is getting super predictive theory, irrespective of the mechanism of this kind of origin of this dark energy, which is responsible for anti-gravity, et cetera, et cetera. If you take minimal theory with minimal number of parameters, you understand that you can take any good theory and make out of it very bad theory. It's not so big deal. Okay, practically it's impossible to make from bad theory good theory. It's, you know, like second law of thermodynamics. But if you will take theory and assume that the same ingredient was responsible for acceleration and for quantum inhomogeneities, then predictions are robust and unambiguous. And first prediction is that if you want to produce inhomogeneities in a big scale, okay, it's possible only when the stage lasts enough to make universe perfectly flat today. What is called, or today the statement is that today it should have Euclidean geometry on large scales. Okay, now, if you tell how non-trivial is this prediction, I can tell you that in 1980, if you would ask astronomer, any astronomer of the universe, which out of these three geometries is realistic, any astronomer will tell you this one, because they were measuring this thing like crazy, and nobody was able to get anything like this one. And if you tell them that, oh, I predict that, okay, the sum of the angle of triangle made out of three galaxies should be 180 degrees, they would tell you, go and consult with your psychiatrist, because you can predict whatsoever, but what we measure, that the sum is less than 180 degrees. I'm not kidding. So, it was the first failure of the theory. Now, second, that perturbation should be adiabatic. What does it mean, this thing? As I told you, you can take two boxes of the same size. Then the amount of matter in both boxes can vary from place to place. For instance, in one box there can be 100 photons, in the other could be 98 photons, right? But if in this box is 50 baryons, then prediction was that in the second there should be 49 baryons. Okay, if you would find 47, you are dead. Of course, this theory, 1980, was also in catastrophic disagreement with the whole Princeton. But okay, of course, it was not tragic, but Princeton, you understand, is sometimes important, especially when it goes about blah, blah, blah. So now, look, at this time, for instance, the most popular theory was developed by Jim Peebles, who was telling that baryons are distributed in homogeneously on the homogeneous foreground of photons. So, people would tell you that if there are 100 photons here, then there should be 100 photons here. Okay? But here should be 40, 50 baryons, and here can be any number of baryons. You see? Because there was again claim that it explains all large-scale structure much better, and okay, these adiabatic perturbations are catastrophic. Situation 1980-1990. Perturbation should be Gaussian. You know what is Gaussian, I do not need to explain it, yeah? So it should be most featureless embryons for the galaxies. So the structure of genes should be the most democratic. Everybody is equal to everybody. You know that most of the information we have in phases. Here the statement was that if, for instance, gravitational potential, which is random Gaussian field, okay, it should be staying Gaussian is 10 minus 5, then non-Gaussianity admixture to this thing, which should be there because of non-linearity of Einstein equation, but it should not exceed the quantity 10 minus 10 multiplied by Q. So prediction for this FNL was that it should be 2 or 3 or 5, whatsoever, depending on the model. If people would find that it's 100, okay, you can forget about your theory. Now, at the same time, at this time, okay, there was developing, people were developing some kind of string, cosmic string theory of galaxy formation textures, where they were telling that F and L about 10,000 explains all the observations much better than anything else. So it was the third failure of the theory. You see, so, okay, I think if theorists would be asked for defend of the PhD to be checked experimentally, then I think I would fail completely here. And the most amazing thing, which was found in both our paper and also Hawking paper, was some number which is 0.96. Okay, let me skip blah, 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 because I am running out of time. And namely, it was found that gravitational potential from galaxy to clusters, etc., should grow logarithmically. You can substitute instead of logarithm, of course, scale in power 1 minus some power, and then you are getting prediction from this thing for ns, that ns, okay, how it's defined, should be 0.96. And from where this non-trivial number 0.96 is coming? From logarithm of the ratio of galactic scale to 1 centimeter or 1 millimeter, which is the typical scale of background radiation. So you see this number 0.96 is not from somewhere, okay? It just tells you about direct interplay of macrophysics in galactic scale with microphysics, because at the earlier times these photons, okay, were extremely hot and had the scale 10 minus 27 centimeter, you see? And, of course, it was the most non-trivial part about which at this time when nobody has seen any fluctuations ever was able to dream that it will be able, okay, it will come out as a result of the measurement. So this was the situation, and I can tell you how robust were these predictions, because now people, some people tell that they can explain anything. Okay, when Lyman Page, still in 2003, 14 years ago, was asking me if I would find, okay, 0.99, would you throw in the toil on inflation? I told him, okay, of course, if you will find plus minus one at the level of 3 sigma, no problem. I can forget about this non-existent theory. Now, what was going on? Okay, the whole science started in 1992 because people started, first of all, to build a lot of telescopes. It's an amazing thing, okay? It's happened like revolution. They were building one large telescope after the other. Before that, they were existed with relatively small telescope, okay? This Russian 6-meter telescope was considered the largest one, perhaps. Now there is a lot of them. But the most amazing thing, actually, the thing started with this satellite mission to find the fluctuation of background radiation. It was Cosmic Background Explorer, the first result of which were published in 1992. This, okay, satellite had three devices. One device, for which Maser was responsible, was supposed to measure Planck spectra. And to prove it, CMB or not CMB, or maybe was produced later. And the other device, for which principal investigator was Smooth, was supposed to try to find the difference, the fraction, or 10 minus 2, okay, 100th fraction of the percent, between two antennas, which look in the direction of the sky larger than, okay, if the angle between them is larger than 7 degrees. And both experiments, the third device, okay, was cleaning that, but okay, doesn't matter. And the result was spectacular. First of all, it's the spectra of background radiation measured by this MASER device, which is an ingenious experiment. And you see here, okay, 400 sigma arrow bars are shown. How many experiments where you have seen when experimentalist would show you 400 sigma arrow bars, and nevertheless, it still stays like falsification. You see, I think it was just undoubtful proof of the primordial origin of this radiation. The other spectacular result, okay, people discovered that the picture of the universe when it was 300,000 years old is not as boring as they thought originally. Okay, and they got some kind of photograph of this universe where from this place to this place, the temperature varies by the fraction of 10 minus 4, 10 minus 5. But of course, picture is not very good. Why? Because resolution of the instrument was not very good. Instrument could see difference in the antenna temperature only if angular distance between antenna was more than 7 degrees, or in terms of so-called multipoles, which is inverse angle, the multipole was more larger or smaller than 60 or 30, yeah? Even. And for instance, 200 multipole corresponds to 1 degree, yeah? And here also you see arrow bars are huge, and it's an avoidable thing because you are making measurement on one representative of statistical ensemble. And for instance, within observable horizons, there are 5 quadrupoles, and you cannot get actually accuracy better than this one. It's unavoidable cosmic variance. Therefore, to get fantastic measurement, you have to go here, where you have many more representatives, 2L plus 1, within our universe, you see? Now, after, okay, this spectacular experiment, people launched a lot of ground-based and balloon experiments. And I have to mention here, okay, the first experiment which went to the scale smaller than 1 degree, okay, with resolution measuring the structure of these embryons, is so-called Taco and Saskatoon, where for the first time Lyman Page was able to see, okay, that this peak is located here, this peak, the location of this peak, let me not go to the detail, allows you to make exact measurement of the geometry of the universe, you see. And the other spectacular experiment was Italian-American experiment made by Pablo De Bernardis and Andrew Lange. Okay, they had this balloon in the South Pole, which was flying at the altitude 42 kilometers. Okay, like this one, this is why it was called boomerang, because the winds are bringing it like this one, and covering small part of the sky 4 by 4 degrees, but with much higher resolution, and they were able to get this point and compare them with prediction. In fact, this was the first real proof of the existence of dark energy in our universe, not supernova, because when, okay, they have seen this second week, it was impossible to explain it, would be impossible, and, okay, having location of this first peak without dark energy. Okay, because this supernova stuff, still 3 sigma, okay, which is not very serious, 3 sigma. Now, also about the same time people discovered something about large-scale structure of the universe, so they were able to take 1 million, redshift of 1 million of galaxies and put them in the space, so they were able to see clusters of galaxies, filament which connects the cluster, walls which connect the filaments, and big voids, the so-called web structure of our universe. And for the first time, it was proven that we live not in the center of spherically symmetrical universe, but we really live in homogeneous and isotropic universe. It was just 17 years ago, okay? And before that, it was just Einstein's so-called cosmological principle, but you know that, okay, principles always are principles. It's good to have some proof. Now, 1996, okay, there are about 80 experiments, 100 experiments, but let me speak about the most decisive. Okay, 1996, NASA and European Space Agency both approved the program of 2 experiments. NASA experiment was WMAP, which was the team of about 30 people, okay? Then there was proposed some experiment, okay, with natural cooling in the space without helium, okay, made on 3 frequencies just to clean the photograph. And it went in the sky, 2001, I guess, was launched. And the first result were released 2003, after 1 year, okay? Results were fantastic in the following sense. First of all, okay, these guys were able to clean all this dust and they got much better picture of the universe, right? And they were able to confirm the basic prediction of the theory after these kind of things, it became undoubtful that the sum of 3 angles in our universe is 180 degrees. Therefore, it's flat. And it came in the agreement with this discovered dark energy and 30% of dark matter in our universe. You see, there was a lot of other experiments, as I said, but let me go, because I have not so much time, to the final point and to the best possible experiment, because it became more or less clear at this time that contrary to what people were thinking, perturbations are adiabatic, more or less Gaussian, but it was not yet final point because, okay, you still could get F and L about 100, yeah? Fonon-Gaussianity, then omega is very close to 1, but some people were claiming that you can still get negative omega as a proof of God knows what. And for NS, only in 2007, these people, I mean from WMAP, after collecting the result of the measurement of for 5 years, they were able to see the first indication on the possible logarithmic growth of the amplitude of the spectra towards to the larger scale. But it was not a definite result yet. And of course, everybody was expecting more definite result from this experiment, which was European experiment, was operating with 9 frequencies. It had 2 main teams. One was Italian, okay, headed by Mandalese, which was responsible for the frequency up to 100 gigahertz, okay, and French team, which were measuring this picture in the frequencies, so-called submillimeter frequencies, up to, I guess, 800 gigahertz. Finally, just after that, to filtrate all dust. Sensitivity of this experiment was 500 times better then for WMAP, and resolution was 5 times better than for WMAP. You see? It was tremendous progress just. But of course, for high frequency instruments, they needed helium, cooling. And they had helium precisely for 3 years, and 3 years it was working perfectly well. When helium was gone, okay, the whole observation was shattered because there was no point to keep the things in the space and spend money for the things which were not bringing anything, yeah? Now, what was this experiment? It was, okay, as I said, two main teams were French and Italian, but of course it was collaboration of all these institutions around the world with 300 people. You see, this was WMAP team. Okay, WMAP is Wilkinson, microwave anisotropy probe, and Wilkinson unfortunately died 2003. Yeah? And this was Planck team. So for the particle physicists, this expansion, like inflation, expansion perhaps, right? Now, and then what they got actually? No, the whole thing, it's not Hollywood, yeah? It's a real movie with launching this Ariane, yeah, in French Guinea. So it goes up, and then disappears. And Sestafio says that he was horrified because, no, now it's Hollywood. And now for 3 years, okay, this instrument covered sky 5 times. Okay, with 9 frequencies, after that you take this dirty picture, clean it up, and you are left with the cleanest photograph of the universe, how it looked like when it was 300,000 years old, and you clearly see all these embryons. Some people managed to see even Stephen Hawking initials here. But it doesn't mean that it was embryon for Stephen Hawking, yeah? So, now, then you take this picture, and, okay, use statistical methods just to extract statistical information from it, right? And also, you recall, but before you do it, I just want to show you what with the growth of resolution, you see? As I said, good Japanese camera versus old Soviet Union camera, you see? Now, look, now, what you are doing, but before you are cleaning and getting data from this thing, I'm finishing in 3 minutes. What you do? You take predictions which were made long ago, okay, and after that, also using astronomy, what you do? You draw this curve, how temperature should depend, okay, depending on the angle between two antennas. Here, angle is like this one. Here, angle is extremely small. And theoretical prediction where you see also imprint of condition in the universe for these embryons which started to develop really, yeah, you are getting a theoretical prediction this curve. Now, if you will take one, all astrophysics, you will determine H0 from supernova, omega lambda also from supernova. Then you will take omega baryon from excellent observation of deuterium abundance by Max Pitini, yeah, which are comparable with everything. Then you will take 4 predictions. Do you know how many parameters in this curve are free? Just one parameter. Just one parameter amplitude, yeah? Which is not prediction of the series. So you take this theoretical prediction, then you take this picture, right, and extract the same curve from this picture. What you get? You get these points. And you see here, arrow bar is 4 times smaller than the size of the point. But here is not 400 sigma, it's just 1 sigma, but I think it's more than enough. And then using one parameter curve, you ask, how good? Here, by the way, you can bring everybody from the street and he will draw you just one curve, yeah? It's not like when a rubara like this one. And you ask, how good is agreement between these two curves? You see? I think I don't need to make any comments here. You see, it should go in CNN on no comments in the section. Moreover, not only this curve is measured, because the bolometers are so sensitive that they can measure polarization of this temperature fluctuation, polarization curves, yeah? Now, which are just 10 times smaller than the fluctuations themselves. When you take this, how it's called, red curve, which is no parameter prediction for this polarization, these points are what you measured in the experiment. You see, I think one should not add anything. Now, what one can conclude from here? No, first of all, one can conclude something about conditions in which embryons were developing, their features. So from this kind of precise curve, you know how much dark energy, dark matter, and baryons we have today, but it's not even so interesting thing. But the most interesting thing is that from this Planck thing, you can find out that with accuracy, half of the percent universe is flat. So sum of angle of triangle, 180 degrees. Contrary to everything what experimentalists were saying in 1980. Perturbations are adiabatic, okay? With maximal admixture due to the, of course, arrow bars, 1% of anything else. Gaussianity is proved at the highest possible level. You know that before release of Planck, people spread it rumor that people see a lot of non-Gaussianity, therefore they managed to organize already a lot of conferences to explain this non-Gaussianity, then result comes, a lot of people, of course, are upset. Conferences went in nothing, yeah? And spectral index was found 0.96 with the accuracy or logarithmic dependence of the spectra was established at least at 6 sigma level, which I think is astonishing even for particle physics, you see? After that, what we are talking about, I think, we all originated from quantum fluctuations, no doubt. And the other thing, okay, very short thing, which I tell you. If I would ask you the question, why do we believe in general relativity? Because we have experiment, but most of the experiment refer only to the weak field. Okay, when you can make perturbation, for instance, or make gravitational wave, etc. Why do we believe we in non-perturbative general relativity, okay, in this Einstein equation. No, because people speak about black holes, but black holes for sure nobody has seen because you have really to fly there to be sure that it's a black hole. But the only place where non-perturbative general relativity is proven is really cosmology, because all these fluctuations which we observe, okay, at a certain point, at the moment when they originate signal, they exceed the scale of causally connected region. Okay, so they are on the scale larger than curvature scale, where the things cannot be linearized. Therefore, I think this cosmology with the latest development is the greatest and the only experimental proof that general relativity is valid from the scale which are 13 billion years up to the scale 10 minus 27 centimeter and valid non-perturbatively even when it's merged with quantum mechanics. Okay, thank you very much, it's all.
Questions?
Everybody's convinced, so no question. Yeah.
Let us be specific on the second statement making the last page, right?
You mean?
We originated from quantum fluctuations.
Right.
Right. Now.
Uh-huh. Okay.
How much of the prediction that you mentioned can definitely be ascribed to that origin. Let me tell you, I mean, the other way around is totally clear in the sense that it's clear that this point of view in which you think that quantum fluctuations are the origin have implications that are qualitative implications that are pretty much in agreement with observation. I would be more happy if one had some more, how can I say, quantitative predictions that I could compare in order to...
Okay, quantitative predictions are, three of them at least are referring entirely to quantum fluctuation. Perturbations are adiabatic, Gaussian, yeah, and the third one is this logarithmic spectrum.
Clear that they come from quantum fluctuations?
Absolutely, because if you use, okay, there is only one thing actually. In expanding the universe, there is only one way to amplify, quantum fluctuation. You use this exponential expansion stage. Now, doesn't matter what you had before, okay, this exponential expansion stage cleans everything besides of quantum fluctuation. But it freezes out quantum fluctuation on all scales which are relevant for us. And everything what is relevant for us is this 70-fold of the stage of exponential expansion. And then if you don't care about anything else, then you are getting an ambiguous prediction, okay, which could be killed if any of these properties would not be confirmed. If Planck would find, as people were thinking, F and L like 40, I told, okay, Linda called me one day before, okay, he told, let's invent some model. I told, okay, I can invent 100 models, But you understand that you cannot generate large non-Gaussianity without spoiling completely predictive theory, because you can do whatever you want if you will take two ingredients, okay? One is responsible for galaxies and the other for exponential expansion. You can forget. You can get whatever you want. But if you insist that you had one ingredient which was responsible for everything, non-confirmation of this thing would kill this theory entirely. You see, if people would find F and L is 40, I tell you that only specialist cosmologists who have nothing else to do would still be writing these kind of crappy papers. Nobody from particle physics community or solid state community would be taking all this kind of complicated stuff seriously. You see, here, minimal assumption. Exponential expansion plus quantum fluctuation, simplest, okay, model. Then, four robust qualitatively different prediction. You see, not quantitatively. As I said, omega equal one, Gaussianity, adiabaticity, and logarithmic spectra.
You mind going back to the point 96? I'm not sure I understood it completely.
Yes, but, okay. Point 96 is related with the fact that when you are amplifying quantum fluctuation, you should not, okay, finish with Sahara. So, therefore, you have to finish this kind of stage which is amplifying fluctuation.
No problem.
You see, when you will assume that these kind of things you have to finish, then, okay, this kind of logarithmic spectra, that perturbation grow towards to the larger scale, and they have to become, if I would think, for instance, approximate without thinking, should be become of the order of one outside of our horizon, they are coming unavoidably, you see, irrespective of any model. So, graceful exit problem or graceful exit of this kind of stage of accelerated expansion give you this 0.96. And as I said, okay, why 0.96? Because logarithm of the ratio of galactic scale to the typical scale of CMB is about around 50. So 2 divided by 50 is 4%, which gives you deviation from n equal 1, precisely. You see, this is the most astonishing thing, because when my friend, experimentalist, okay, Lyman Page, I told him, okay, look for this thing. Fortunately, they didn't listen a lot of theorists who were telling whatsoever, but then Lyman, when they have seen for the first time these indications, that he cannot fit with n equal 1, the thing, that he has to get 0.95, 0.96. He knows that his hairs stand up, you see, Because it's very non-trivial thing when the thing is growing towards the large scale. There is no any natural explanation.
Can you say something more, please, about the presumed validity of GR in the strong field regime?
Okay. So, for instance, this picture which we see with Planck today, is formed by perturbation when at the moment, when this radiation decoupled, have a scale larger than speed of light multiplied by 300,000 years. Okay? So, and this is the scale of four-dimensional curvature. So this picture, which we are considering, is built by inhomogeneities, which are evolving in the strong field, and these inhomogeneities are on the scale larger than the curvature scale. This is the reason why, for instance, this theory is impossible to do perturbatively in Minkowski space. Because most of the other problems, for instance, which are related with observation, how people do in general relativity, they take as background Minkowski space, and then they linearize theory or write higher order correction. Here it's in principle impossible. Here you have to use, general relativity in all its complexity. Because you are dealing with a scale larger than the scale of four-dimensional curvature in building this picture. About, you mean that this kind of crap, which is now people writing in Scientific American, and these distinguished people assigning letters, first of all.
Wait, what is it?
You see, there was, during recent time, the following noise on internet, First of all, 2 months ago, Steinhardt published some paper, about multiverse or whatsoever, because you see, when people took this idea about 70 e-folds and after that started to exercise their vocabulary, it became multiverse, God knows what, without writing any new formulas, for 30 years, it became the field of theology. And now, Steinhardt took this thing as it's presented right now, and told that, this theory is describing everything, et cetera, because Gauss was making together with Linda statements that they can describe everything, right? After that, a few days ago, there appeared some letter signed by 33 physicists where they wrote that they disagree with Steinhardt and company, but they didn't even write why they disagree. So the whole story reminded me old Soviet times when people were writing collective letters, That we disagree with this thing, but in Soviet times, actually, the consequences of these letters were very bad, People were going to concentration camps. In America, it's still not the case. I think it's just the bad taste to discuss for the public the questions which, about which public has no idea, and even most of the people who sign some letters, they have no idea what they are discussing. What can I say else? You see, I can go in details, on both sides, but I believe that both sides made complete mess, and the best for the good of everybody will be to forget both things, this controversy. But it's unfortunate situation that it looks like sometimes actually science also becomes like political science instead of natural science. What can I say? I can tell you more if you are interested in a particular point, but I think most of the people are just interested to see, who will kill whom, irrespectively who is right. This is like in circus, right? Nobody cares about truth. Everybody just entertain himself with the zoo or, circus whatsoever.
Just one last quick question. You discussed past measurements. What needs to be done in the next future
In next future, okay, would be of course good to find what Bicep claims that they found. But I can tell you inflation had, okay, one more prediction in this sense. Because when Bicep appeared, okay, I said from the very beginning, you can check, it's not a joke, okay? Few days after that, I told the three guys, Planck, Bicep, and Sieri cannot go together. One should die. I made this prediction in Süddeutsche Zeitung, okay, because it was just, because they were not just compatible with each other, yeah? If Bicep and Planck simultaneously would be correct, then, okay, Sieri would be in a rubbish form. Of course, you can shape the spectrum, but it would be disaster for the Sieri. But as you know, Bicep died. But because they have seen dust instead of gravitational waves. But now, you understand that before spectral index was measured, there was no even low bound on the amount of gravity wave. After spectral index is measured, you can make rigorous bound, of course, up to the uncertainty in the measurement. And in principle, would not be so bad to find gravitational wave, okay, or B mode of polarization, thanks to gravitational waves. But on the other hand, besides of this thing, what refers to cosmology, I do not see too much. You see, I think after a certain point, actually Planck closed a certain chapter for cosmology. But for astrophysics, there is brilliant future, especially taking into account all these experiments which will be done. You see, like Euclid, there is a lot of space mission, telescopes, et cetera, et cetera. So it's flourishing. Astrophysics is a flourishing field of the research. But it doesn't refer to the origin of the universe as a whole, okay? We were somehow happy to have this CMB period, but you understand that good things are also dying. Everything is dying, okay? And better things, shorter time life is normally.
We can thank the speaker and go for a small refreshment on the other side of the floor. Just to remind you, the last colloquium of this year will be held on June 28th, and it will be devoted to chemistry. Good afternoon.